up late today and I still feel the sting of the pain, but I brush my teeth anyway. I got dressed through the mess and put a smile on my face. I got a little bit stronger.
WGSN-DB, Going Solo Network, welcomes you to award-nominated relationship internet radio talk show, Going Solo with Cece. Host Cece Schatz is a speaker, author, blogger, and the leading transitional divorce and dating coach with My Friends Connect and Going Solo Next Step. Now, together, let's join Cece.
Hello there. This is Cece with Going Solo and also the Business Showcase. Today, we are going to showcase a business leader from Fairlawn, New Jersey. He is a licensed insurance broker, Stephen Kolbrin. Welcome to the show.
Thank you so much, Cece. It's my pleasure to be here.
Well, it is a delight to have you. The reason we connected is because you had a terrific article out there with regards to insurance. So tell us, before we go into that article and how it can really help everyone, tell us how you got into the field of insurance.
Well, long story short, it's a family tradition. My father, Leon, a blessed memory, was an active life insurance general agent in the 1950s, 60s, and 70s. And I really grew up in his agency, working there as a kid all the way through college. So in essence, the sale of life insurance became part of my DNA. And later on, after I graduated college and spent some time in the work world, I eventually launched a full-time career in life insurance sales. And I've been there ever since. That was 25 years ago.
Life insurance, everybody kind of poo-poos it a little bit because they think, oh, you know what? I really don't need it. I worked in probate for a while. If anyone knows my background, I started as a legal secretary, then worked my way up into actually being assistant paralegal. And I found that because we did probate, I could see the lives changing of others as their deceased ones went on. And, you know, we had to process their estate and things like that. And I know in a lot of states, and I don't know all states, but where we're at, the life insurance doesn't pass through your estate. But I can tell you the ones that had life insurance, they were the beneficiaries of where the insurance paid them directly. It was, as we could say, a godsend, so to speak.
Oh, yeah, I agree. So just a few of your points, I think you're right. I think that statistics will tell you that the vast majority of the population are underinsured, meaning they don't have a policy, or if they do have a policy, it's not large enough. And I think that is unfortunate. Throughout my career, I've participated in the settlement of a lot of claims, and I can tell you firsthand, there's a big difference between a grieving, surviving spouse getting enough money, not enough money, or more than enough money. It makes quite a difference. I guess one other point you mentioned is, yeah, life insurance does bypass probate, and that's one legal advantage to it. People have a lot more control. I am licensed in 48 states, every place except Alaska and Hawaii, so I'm familiar with how many states work. And in all these cases, the beneficiary gets the policy directly from the company.
You're licensed in several states, and so why is that so important to the individual that's buying insurance, life insurance?
You mean the fact that I'm licensed in different states?
Yeah.
Well, legally, the life insurance salesperson has to be licensed in the state of sale so that even though I'm physically located in New Jersey, if I had a client in Florida, for example, I need to be licensed in Florida in order to be able to help them. That's really just the way law works. Life insurance is regulated on a state-by-state basis. Therefore, if you want to service folks across the country, you need to be licensed in every state of the country to do so. So I've managed to do it. And this way, I have a client base stretching from Maine to Washington to Florida to California.
That's marvelous. You know, because the thing is when we're dealing with our finances, any type of finances for anything, we want to make sure that when we make a decision, we're dealing with number one expert in that field and that they do have all the certifications and the licensing that's needed because we're really trusting their knowledge of that information so that we make the correct decision. So it's great that you are really a true professional in your field. And I appreciate you coming on the show with us here.
Well, thank you. I'm glad you see that. There's these days, in the last 20 years, state insurance departments have really upgraded the standards that professionals have to meet in order to retain their licenses. So, for example, I have to go through 24 credits of continuing education every 2 years to keep my license. Once I satisfy the requirements for New Jersey, then they're satisfied as well for all the other states because there are reciprocal arrangements among the states. But because you have to go through these constant continuing education classes, pretty much your industry knowledge, your product knowledge, your knowledge of the laws that affect your practice, they're really all up to date. And therefore, you're right, then the buying public is dealing with a professional. And I would add this one other point. I think that these days there's a tendency for especially people in the financial services industry to cross-sell, meaning somebody who sells insurance also sells annuities. Somebody who sells annuities also sells investments and on and on. However, my practice is based solely on the sale of life insurance, and it's been that way for 25 years. And I've done this because I think you can't serve the public if you're a jack of all trades and master of none. I think you really need to specialize so you can truly say, I know this product and I know the marketplace better than anyone. And I think you need to be at that level of performance to really show your client expertise.
Exactly. I agree with that wholeheartedly. You really, it's great to know, really, that you have really honed in on, number one, your passion, helping people, and the other is using the vehicle of life insurance because you want to make sure that you know all the ins and outs of everything that's related to that, and so that is very important. So let me ask you some direct questions with regards to what I do, and of course, I deal a lot with divorce, recovery, and transition into dating and relationships, and as we go through that movement of divorce through the recovery period, we start analyzing where we're at, and finances is one of those things. And insurance is so vital to us because we do want to make sure that we protect ourselves, we protect other people that we love. And so when I'm asking you that, a couple of questions that I have is, number one, what is the difference between whole life and term insurance?
Sure. There are two types of life insurance: term insurance and permanent insurance, and they differ in two ways. The first way they differ is the term period in which the premium is guaranteed. So, for example, if you bought 10-year term insurance, you'd have a premium guarantee for 10 years. If you bought 30-year term insurance, you'd have a premium guarantee for 30 years. If you bought permanent insurance, you could arrange it so that you have a lifetime guarantee on the premium. Those factors are necessary to consider when you're making the purchase and you're budgeting for the purchase, and you really need to know what is going to be the long-term cost of this product. The other way they differ is with regards to living benefits, also called cash value. Term insurance is a product that provides pure protection. There's no cash accumulation to use while you're still alive. Permanent insurance can be designed to grow cash so that you can use that while you're still alive. So the model I use to really make the difference clear is this. You can rent a house, and the rent you pay, the monthly premium you pay, will be cheaper, and you won't have any equity in the house. You could buy a house, your monthly payment will be higher, but you'll have something to show for your money in terms of equity in the house. So similarly, term insurance equates to renting, and permanent insurance equates to buying. So that's the simple model. And we take it from there to really see, does somebody want to have equity in their policy or not? Really, what is most suitable for their need for life insurance?
Okay, can you buy life insurance on anyone? Like, could I insure, for instance, my ex because he pays me alimony? Would I be able to insure him? So if something happens to him, I would still then, I would have some sort of economic transition there? I mean, is that possible to do that?
That's a really good question. And the case you mentioned is certainly legitimate. There's such a thing in insurance law called insurable interest. And believe it or not, it relates to a certain code of morality that life insurance companies have held for centuries. They really want to avoid a situation where somebody is up to no good, takes out a policy on somebody else, commits a horrible crime, and collects the money. To tell you the truth, that is one of the reasons why insurance companies these days want there to be insurable interest. So what is insurable interest? The case you mentioned is a perfect example. We have a spouse who had been financially dependent on the other spouse. Now, unfortunately, the marriage is terminating, but there's still a financial dependence. So therefore, it's very legitimate to take out life insurance on the former spouse. God forbid they passed away, you'd still have a need for money. So that's one big reason why I've gotten involved a lot in helping folks purchase life insurance related to a divorce decree, because there's still that kind of financial dependence. And you can take that a step further. People certainly have financial dependence on spouses while they're married. Sometimes there's even a situation where a parent becomes dependent on a child again. A 70-year-old parent moves in with a 45-year-old child, and that parent actually needs life insurance on the child because the child is now supporting them. That's kind of a new need for life insurance these days. And there's many other examples of financial dependence related to businesses and even to charities.
Okay, so let me ask you, what are the things that you would need if you were going to, you know, get insurance for either yourself or if you were going to insure someone else for your insurable interest, information-wise?
Well, it starts out with financial information. Just like anything else, you need to know what you want to buy. For example, if you wanted to buy a house, you need to know what kind of house you want to buy, what kind of rooms, and on and on and on. If you want to buy life insurance, you need the basics of how much insurance do I need, who would benefit, for how long do I need to keep that coverage in force. With regards to a divorce, sometimes it's really spelled out in the divorce decree. Things I've seen are one spouse has to agree to pay alimony, let's say, 10 years or for 15 years until a certain event triggers the dissolution of that, such as remarry or so on. But the term, the coverage period, is spelled out. And that kind of makes it easy to therefore say, all right, well, I need 10-year term insurance or 15-year term insurance and so on. If somebody needs life insurance for other reasons, such as college funding or for a business reason, then you also need to calculate how much insurance is needed, and for how long should the policy be kept in force. So those are the fundamentals. That's step one. And then step two is you need to get pre-qualified for coverage, which means you need to tell your broker answers to the whole gamut of questions which are asked on an application that would be underwritten. And all those questions relate to mortality. They range from your current health, to your medical history, to your lifestyle, to your hobbies, and many other categories. You need to disclose this to your broker because it's the answers to these questions which help the broker determine which company and which product would be most competitive. So the financial questions are key, and the underwriting related questions are also key. And once the broker has that information, then the broker can provide a quote to you that is both competitive and reliable. Reliable meaning that the broker is confident you will be approved at that rate quoted when you finally go through underwriting.
Now, is there a certain amount of insurance where you don't have to worry necessarily about the underwriting, that you're like automatically approved?
Good question. Yes. That's called either guaranteed issue or simplified issue, which means that they'll either ask one or two very basic questions that deal with, do you have a terminal illness, unfortunately, or something like that, or they'll ask a few more basic questions trying to rule out very severe medical conditions. Those are available, and the advantages they pose are that you won't have to go through a physical exam, you won't have to donate blood or urine specimens, and your medical records won't get reviewed, and typically those policies are issued pretty quickly. The negatives for that are that typically the face amount is low because obviously the insurance company doesn't want to expose themselves to huge claims without completely underwriting you. And the other disadvantage is that those are pricey because the insurance companies know they're basically inheriting claims. They know that people buying these policies already have serious illness or other risks, and they can expect to pay out money sooner. But those are available.
Now, would that type of policy be easier to get if you were going to insure somebody that if I wanted to insure my ex or if I wanted to insure parent or something like that, would that be a little bit easier for me? Then I wouldn't need to necessarily let them know and I wouldn't have to get all of their medical insurance information?
So what you're really talking about is getting insurance on somebody without their knowledge. Is that right?
Yes. Is that possible to do that? Is that a no-no?
Okay. It is not a no-no. First, let me explain that the products I just spoke about that are guaranteed issue and simplified issue are not for the purpose you mentioned. They are really quick and easy, small policies, which I have to tell you are really not suitable for most people because really what they cover is burial money. And most people, especially in a divorce situation, need a lot more on the ex-spouse than burial money. They need to replace income. They need to pay off debts. They need to pay for college, maybe something business-related. So we're really not talking about these little, simple, little, quick and easy policies. Okay. Now, for those occasions where you have you need to buy insurance on somebody without their knowledge, that is possible by what's called excess market carriers, meaning that these are companies that take on higher risks and extraordinary types of risks. They're not your mainstream carriers that you see advertised during the Super Bowl type of thing, but they're certainly financially healthy. Sometimes they have a worldwide presence, and they will allow you to buy a policy on somebody without their knowledge under very specific circumstances. One circumstance is that if a divorce decree mandates that a person must carry life insurance and they absolutely refuse, but you have in writing that they're obligated and you reach the point of no return, let's say where legally you just can't force them to comply, an insurance company will issue a policy simply based on your disclosures about them. They won't interview that person. They won't get any kind of lab specimens. They won't get medical records. They'll ask you to answer the yes or no questions, and there's not too many of them. And as a matter of fact, they'll issue the policy quickly, and you can buy a substantial amount of life insurance if you wanted to. The only kicker is, as you can imagine, you're going to pay a lot more for the policy than ordinarily you would, and those policies typically last only 1 year at a time. These are important things to mention because they really should be treated as a last resort. The best way to do this is to get somebody's cooperation to meet the terms of the divorce decree, agree to go through underwriting, because this way you'll be able to pay less money and you'll be able to lock in the guarantee of the premium for a much longer period of time. That's why policies where nobody knows they're being insured are considered a last resort.
Okay. That makes sense. That does make sense. So that brings the question then to beneficiaries. So how do you go about insuring, you know, as you're going through divorce, let's say, and I had a friend, this happened to a friend recently, where they're getting a divorce and he's got a life insurance policy. He's going to go ahead and give that over to her on him. And she can go ahead and make the premiums, but he wants to be able to retain who he has as a beneficiary. So she's questioning me about that. Well, what do you think? And I'm thinking, well, if he remarries or whatever, he could easily change his beneficiary. So she needs to get it somehow in writing in the divorce decree that she would be secured in that. How would she go about it from the insurance standpoint if that wasn't in writing? Or what do we need to do? What are some tips on trying to figure out who is the best, you know, way of wording it for the beneficiary, or how should we look at that?
Really key point there. That has to deal with who owns the policy. The person that owns the policy controls the policy and therefore can change the beneficiary. You basically have four parties to a life insurance contract. You have the insured, obviously, that's the person whose life we're insuring. You have the owner, you have the beneficiary is the one who gets the benefit, and you have the premium payer. So as I mentioned, the owner rules. So if you have a situation where, unfortunately, Mr. and Mrs. Jones are divorcing, and Mrs. Jones wants life insurance on Mr. Jones, but Mr. Jones does own the policy, then you're exactly right. He can get remarried. put the new Mrs. Jones down as the beneficiary and cut off the old Mrs. Jones from receiving the benefit, and she can do nothing about that. The insurance company is going to honor the dictates of the owner. So to solve the problem you mentioned, Mrs. Jones needs to be the owner of the policy on Mr. Jones. So that could either be working with a lawyer to change the ownership of the current policy, and there's a few tax considerations that have to be discussed with the attorney, or you take out a new policy with Mrs. Jones being the owner from day one. Therefore, she controls it. She can make sure she's down as the beneficiary, and only she has the power to change.
If you're starting your divorce, and you're at the very beginning of your divorce, and you decide that we need to look at the insurance, so what you really do need to do is kind of talk with your potential ex and or your soon-to-be ex and try to work out this to see if you could come up with an agreement on starting the insurance policy out at the beginning, so this way there's no hiccups to it.
Oh, yeah. Yes. Part of the divorce settling process should be agreements on how the life insurance should be structured. That is the win-win for everybody. It avoids future problems. And divorce attorneys understand the critical role that life insurance policies play in these agreements. And they are certainly advocates for getting it done the right way to avoid all the kinds of problems that we're discussing here. So yeah, I mean, if you wanted to put together a list of the top five things that have to be addressed in a divorce decree, the proper structuring of life insurance has got to be on that list.
Definitely. I can definitely see the importance to that. So what about your children? I know a lot of times that's what we're thinking, is that we want to make sure. I know a lot of individuals are thinking about securing their alimony, securing the income that they might have received if they're not going to be able to receive that anymore. But at the end of the day, when we are couples and we have children, we always think about what's going to happen to us when we pass, that we want to make sure that our family's secure, that our family's taken care of. So when we think about making as a beneficiary, is it possible to have more than one a beneficiary to your life insurance?
That's also a good question. The answer is yes. There's a primary beneficiary and a contingent beneficiary. The primary beneficiary gets the money as long as they're alive, obviously. But what happens? Yeah, let's take a look at a family tragedy. Mr. and Mrs. Jones are divorced, and Mrs. Jones is the beneficiary of the policy on Mr. Jones, and unfortunately she dies. And there are kids, and she's primarily responsible for those kids, and they're minors. She could have named those kids as the contingent beneficiary, which could entitle them to get the life insurance benefit if, unfortunately, Mrs. Jones was no longer alive. But here's the kicker. The kicker is a life insurance company is not going to pay out money to a minor. And you can imagine there's very good reason not to. So this means that as part of her estate planning, as part of her life planning, Mrs. Jones needs to make provisions for somebody to take care of those kids and take care of the money for those kids until they're no longer minors. So the right way to handle this would have been, for example, that she might have set up a trust. And the money, and if unfortunately she predeceases her kids, then the money goes into a trust, and there's a trustee, and there's a custodian, there's people looking out for the kids to distribute the money, you know, the right amount of money at the right time for the right reason type of thing. So that's just one example of a number of ways attorneys will make provisions so that the kids are cared for financially and otherwise during that unfortunate time when a parent that's responsible for them dies. I have to say that if that doesn't take place, then it can become a war, because now you could have a substantial amount of money in a life insurance policy and the insurance company's got to pay it out. And let's say it's $2 million or $3 million. And they got to pay somebody, but they're not going to pay the minors, and you know the kids are 10 and 12. And so the insurance company is going to hand it over to some court, and the court's going to say, all right, somebody prove they're responsible for these kids. And the ex-husband might say, well, I'm the one. And but then the sister of Mrs. Jones might say, well, you haven't been here for 5 years, and I've been helping, you know, Mrs. Jones take care of these kids the last 5 years. That could be a horrible, horrible scene. of people basically fighting over the kids and fighting over the money.
Yeah, I've seen it too, and it's very, very sad, and it's very painful. It's extremely painful for all parties. So I really think that we should, as individuals, take control of our lives, and we should also take control of our destinies. And part of that is planning our estates. Part of it is looking at ourselves, that we may not be here on this earth, so how can we make it a little bit easier for our families? And I've often said the biggest gift you can give your family is to have a will and have go to an estate attorney and just, I mean, spend $100 or $150 and sit down and pick their brain and figure out what you need to do to be able to secure. So when you're gone, you don't, your family doesn't have to be up in arms and like, oh my gosh, what are we going to do? And then Gigi starts fighting with Frankie and everybody gets into a big war when they could be just a loving family grieving over someone that they actually miss. So I really do feel that we need to be smart about divorce. We need to be smart about looking at our finances, smart about getting all the professional help that we need. And I think seeing someone like yourself, an insurance broker that handles and specializes in life insurance, talk about those type of sticky questions with you and figure out what is the best policies. There, like you said, there's so many different kinds of policies, different kinds of ways. Talk about your finances to figure out, well, what is going to suit your needs now? If you can't afford it, then what can happen to you later? How can you work up to it? So it's very, very important. Very important.
I'm glad you said that, Cece. And, you know, it relates to a point you made initially about, gee, you know, a lot of people don't have life insurance. And, like, why is that? I'm going to speak philosophically for a second. Life insurance is a very unique product because it's paid out when somebody dies. And what's interesting about it is that it's the only form of insurance somebody could buy where they're guaranteed that a claim will be paid. You can buy car insurance and never get into an accident. You can buy medical insurance and never get hurt or sick, and on and on and on and on. But you know you're going to die, and therefore you buy life insurance. And if you keep that policy in force, you guarantee that somebody's going to get the benefit. But the issue is that, especially these days, these times, we don't talk about death a lot. We have a hard time dealing with people getting sick and people dying. But if you look at ancient cultures, these folks understood that things happen in life and they make preparations. And it may sound funny, but if the ancient people knew there was life insurance, they'd be buying it because they know that death is part of life type of thing. So I think that one reason why a lot of people don't have the product is they haven't really thought about facing up to what happens in life and just dealing with it. And if they did, they'd say, you're right, my time could come. Who knows when it's going to come? I'd better be prepared. That's a smart thing to do. So what I find interesting is that a lot of times when people go through divorce, they kind of wake up and they're like, wow, life isn't always what I thought it was. Got married 20 years ago, banking on a dream, and unfortunately it turned into a nightmare. And they kind of realize, I got to get my act together. So what it's so interesting to me about how a lot of times people go through divorce have a more realistic perspective on life than a lot of people for whom life is just a bowl of cherries. And they're like, they're very pro insurance because they realize, hey, things can happen. So I better get a policy.
It is. So let's talk about the insurance itself. How do you know, because there's so many scams out there, how do you know that you're actually having a good insurance company that's going to back you, that is going to be there after you're long and gone? They are going to pay out. How can you be sure that you are getting a vehicle that really will work for you?
It's a good question. I think it's pretty straightforward. Basically, there's a lot of rating agencies these days. There's one in particular called AM Best that monitors the life insurance industry in particular. And my basic formula for recommending a company is they need to be rated A or better by AM Best. And having said that, as long as I've been given no red flags about any potential financial difficulties down the road, I'm happy to recommend them. That is basically the bottom line. At that point, I know I can sleep at night and I'm not going to get any angry phone calls from people like, how come I don't have my benefit check? I think that's fine. And that applies basically to when people buy term insurance or they buy a permanent product where there's no cash, they just want a long-term guarantee. If somebody wants a cash-rich product where they want to grow a lot of cash inside the policy for while they're alive. I might be a little bit more stringent in the ratings. I might take a more careful look at the financials, because not only do you want the widows and the orphans to get paid, so to speak, but you want there to be a hefty amount of money inside the policy while you're alive. So having said all that, I don't think it's an issue these days. And I think 20 years ago, there was much more of a concern, and you heard about insurance companies failing and having problems. And I think that since that time, insurance companies have self-regulated, as they usually do, where on an industry basis, they adopt their own standards in terms of where they invest their money. And the insurance industry has done a very good job of monitoring its own self and maintaining its own financial health, even to the point where 20 years ago, when there were insurance company failures, what typically happened is that other companies bought their obligations, meaning that one company would take on this book of business, another company would take on that book of business, so that at the end of the day, the policyholders and the beneficiaries got their money. It's just that other companies took up the obligations. So following the formula I mentioned, I just don't think it's an issue these days. There's no reason to go to what I call a grade B company or a company with a lesser name, because there's so many grade A companies to choose from these.
Absolutely. And with you being licensed, you know you're going to protect your license. You're not going to recommend anything that you don't feel secure in, because this is what you do for a living. This is your profession. So you're going to protect that. And that's why it's so important to go with someone like here, yourself, that is licensed, that is a professional, that does know the ins and outs and what to stay away from if it's not rated correctly. And so you're not going to put someone in a vehicle that isn't going to work for them, because you have your own reputation on the line.
You're right. Thanks for saying that. And I'll tell you something, it relates to another topic here. Yeah, I take this very seriously. I want to be able to sleep at night. I invest heavily in clients. I don't get paid until somebody signs on the dotted line and says, yes, I'm buying this policy and I'm paying for it. So sometimes I have to put months of time and effort into a candidate in order to get them the right price and the right policy. So I invest in people. And at the end of the day, if they don't get paid, then this is for nothing. So I take it seriously.
Absolutely.
But it also brings up another interesting, unique part of life insurance, which is life insurance is underwritten at the time of application, meaning that when you buy a policy, you go through full disclosure. You tell about your medical history and your hobbies and your financial record, your criminal record, all the 20 questions that are asked during underwriting. And frankly, I think that life insurance is the most thoroughly underwritten financial product on the marketplace. You don't go through the same tenacious underwriting buying a house that you do buying life insurance. In a lot of cases, you don't go through the same underwriting buying a business that you do buying life insurance. But okay, it's underwritten at the time of claim, but after that, you're home free. It's not underwritten again. So I like to say you could be a couch potato right now with no medical history and no adventurous hobbies like mountain climbing or anything like that, and you're going to pay a certain price. And after that, you could become a chain-smoking, bungee-jumping mercenary, and they're stuck with you because you've made certain life changes after you bought the policy, and that's tough on them. You've changed your life, but they're not going to re-underwrite you. So it works in your favor, and the only thing that makes this work is you have to go through full disclosure. Full disclosure means that you have to answer the questions thoroughly and accurately and honestly. And once I'm satisfied you've done this, and once the company is satisfied you've done this, they're going to offer you a price, and they're going to stick to it. And the only reason why they wouldn't stick to it is if in the first 2 years, unfortunately, you committed suicide or you committed insurance fraud. And if, unfortunately, you did try to get away with something and the claim was filed in the first 2 years, the insurance company has the right to say, hold on, we got to investigate this and see if there was any funny business. And if there was funny business, they wouldn't pay out. But the way I practice it, we avoid that possibility entirely because I help people go through full disclosure.
That is so important. You think about it, you get insurance, and I recommend this, to get insurance when you're younger, because number one, your rates are down. and it's much better for you, and especially if you're going to look at the having some sort of cash value with it. But if you get it when you're younger, who knows what your life is going to be like as you get older. And so this way you're guaranteed to be able to have some sort of life insurance policy. So it's a great thing to have. So let me ask you, since I'm approaching my senior years, and I've been listening, and I think we talked about this on the phone prior, I was listening to a television broadcast that was talking about being able to get a vehicle of some sort of insurance where you could actually obtain it. And I know you're not a tax attorney, so we probably would want to talk to a tax attorney, of course, about anything you're going to do with your to try to save on your taxes. But they were saying something about you could have some sort of, and you could get some sort of life insurance policy that you would be able to withdraw funds that would be somehow tax-free. Do you know anything about this at all?
Yes, I do. There is permanent life insurance, which I mentioned earlier, which can develop cash. And life insurance receives favorable tax treatment by the Treasury Department, which means that the cash in the life insurance policy can grow tax deferred, paying tax on the earnings on a year-by-year basis. And at the same time, they can be removed from the policy on a tax-free basis, either through what's called withdrawals or loans. Now, you're right in saying that you need a tax advisor to figure this stuff out, but that's the basic framework. So, in essence, you can grow money inside life insurance, so-called, in quotes, tax-free. But there's really no such thing as a free lunch here. Meaning, for instance, a lot of times when you take money out of the life insurance, you may not have to pay tax on it, but in all likelihood, it's going to reduce the amount of the death benefit. So let's say you have $1 million and your beneficiary needs $1 million, but you want to take out $100,000 from your cash account. Okay, if properly structured, you may not pay taxes on that $100,000, but if you die the next day, your beneficiaries only get $900,000. So there's a trade-off you have to make. And you need to be advised about that. You need to be aware of that. Anytime somebody asks me about the advisability, should I take the money out kind of thing, that's the first question I pose. I say, look, you bought this policy 5 years ago, and you told me you needed this amount of insurance for your wife or for your husband or for your business. You take out the money, fine, but it's going to reduce the benefit. Is that what you want? Okay, so you need to be aware of that. And the second thing you need to be aware of is that you get what you pay for. If you want to use life insurance as a cash accumulation vehicle, it's going to cost you a lot more than the premium. So there's a budgetary consideration. How much money do you want to spend on life insurance? And is life insurance, and if you do want to spend extra money on some kind of savings plan, is life insurance the best vehicle for doing that? So your tax attorney has to advise you, plus your investment guy has to advise you and say, well, you could grow money inside life insurance and this should be your return, or you could grow money outside life insurance and this should be your return, which works best.
Wow. Life insurance really has a great importance in your life when you're living. And so there's a lot of different decisions that we have to make, whether we're going to go through a divorce or we're not going to go through a divorce. So if you're listening to the show and you're not going through a divorce, know that you need to be looking at your life insurance and looking at your life in itself, your finances, and be where you're at with things. And if you don't have life insurance, it's not something that you should just kiss off and think, oh, well, I'm not going to worry about it. I'm not going to worry about my family after I'm gone. Hard statement to make, and it's a hard way of leaving your family. So life insurance is definitely something, it's a vehicle for you. It's a vehicle for you to protect your income if you're having income coming in from another means such as alimony or something like that. It's a way of protecting your family after you're gone. It's a way of protecting some of your income from taxes if you get with your tax attorney and determine if that's a good vehicle for you. It's kind of a win situation, really, for a lot of individuals. So do we want to make another payment? No. I mean, come on, who wants to go and dig in their wallet and make another payment? But if it means that the end result is going to give you and your family the security, hey, maybe we need to be thinking about it. So I thank you, Steve, for being on the show today. So tell us how we can get a hold of you.
Well, you're welcome, Cece, and it was my pleasure. So So here's my contact information. I have a toll-free direct line, 866-633-1818. I have a direct email. It's skobrin@stephencobrin.com. It's skobrin@stephencobrin.com. That's Stephen with a V. And I have a website, which is called approvedasquoted.com. And I also have a blog, planriskliv.com. Go to one of those sources. You'll find out a lot and a good way to reach me.
Yeah, I really love your blogs, too. I was looking over your website, and there was a lot of interesting information on your blogs. You're very well written and a lot of information packed there and entertaining, too. So I thought they were really great blogs. So I do appreciate you taking the time and writing those, because I think they do help individuals out there figure out what their needs are and kind of trigger. Maybe I need to be checking out this and looking into something. So thank you for that.
Thank you. You are welcome.
And we will definitely put all of your information right on our website, WGSN-DB, Going Solo Network. It will be right there on the front page. If you just go into some of the guests that we have with links, Stephen is going to be there for you. His information will be ready, and you can just go in and click on it when you're ready to talk to someone about your insurance needs. He is from Fair Lawn, New Jersey. And he is licensed a broker for life insurance from 48 states. So he's pretty much got it covered. So he can help you with any of your life insurance needs for sure. So I thank you, Stephen, for being on Going Solo with CeCe and also being one of our business leaders, our experts on the Business Showcase show. So I appreciate that.
You are welcome, CeCe. Thank you so much for having me on. It's been my pleasure.
Well, it was terrific. I tell you what, I learned a great deal in this short period of time, and I do appreciate you sharing all of your expertise, knowledge on life insurance. It's made me kind of stop for a minute and think about, you know, maybe I need to be looking at my own life, my own insurances, and make sure that I have things in place for people that I love. So I appreciate you taking the time with us today, and I'm sure that the listeners out there are going to start looking at their finances and looking at their family and say, you know, maybe I need to reevaluate my life too. So I thank you again, Stephen, for being on the show, and we'll make sure we have all the information right there on our website so it's easy access for everyone.
Wonderful. Thank you.
You're welcome. All right. Bye-bye for now. This is CeCe with Going Solo and also the Business Showcase, really focusing on some of our business leaders that are the movers, shakers within their industry. And we had Stephen Kolbrin. He is a licensed insurance broker in Fair Lawn, New Jersey. He handles 48 states, so wherever you're living, he probably can help you with any of your life insurance needs. We hope that you will contact him. His information will, again, be on the website so that you can get it. Don't hesitate giving him a call. His toll-free number is 866-633-1818. His contact information will be there for you. So just shoot him out an email. Let him know that you're interested. And check out his website. He'll definitely be able to help you with all of your insurance needs. And his website is approvedasquoted.com. So make sure that you check it out. Read his blog and get familiar with him. You know the people that you're doing business with. Feel secure with them. And make sure that they are professionals as Stephen Kolbrin is. So thank you. This is CeCe signing out. And I can't wait to talk to you next time. Bye for now. I'm getting stronger with